We all love the sound of money, and a $1,500 sign-on bonus sounds even better. That's right, Belicio Foods of Jackson is offering a $1,500 sign-on bonus to new employees. Receive an extra $100 your first 6 weeks, then $400 after day 90, and $500 after day 180. Don't wait. Apply online at BeliciOFoods.com/careers today. That's BeliciOFoods.com/careers. Come work for a company who truly values their employees. Come work for Belicio Foods. It's time to reveal the prize and clue start dates for Cycle Search 2022, presented by Total Media, along with the Tri-State Power Sports Superstore, Honda Suzuki Polaris Can-Am of Jackson. This year's prize is a KO250 dirt bike, along with an accessory package valued at over $4,500. That's right, a KO250 dirt bike. Clues begin on Monday, February 14th, Valentine's Day. There'll be one clue each day, Monday through Friday, till the prize pack is found. Pack is hidden somewhere in the listening area. Be safe when searching, and good luck. It's Cycle Search 2022, sponsored by Total Media and Honda Suzuki Polaris Can-Am of Jackson.
Show some love for the graduating seniors in your life with custom-made gear from Zip Printing in Jackson. Yard signs, banners, screen-printed t-shirts, and more. Zip Printing can do it all. Visit yourtotalmedia.shop to browse all of Zip's gear to show your school spirit for the class of 22. Zip also has everything you need for graduation parties, like custom photo cards, invitations, and napkins. Call 740-286-3023 or find them on Facebook at Zip Printing Signs and Marketing.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to another edition of The Morning Show right here on Main Street TV. Of course, it is Friday, and for once in our lives, the sun is shining.
Yay!
This could just be a round of applause all day. Woo! The sun is shining, the birds are chirping, the pollen is definitely pollinating, and we're going to have 71 degrees in the forecast.
That's amazing.
So embrace, enjoy this day, because then it all goes to pot again.
Well, if it wasn't for being here on TV and you have to keep your hair, I would have been riding the motorcycle up here because the weather is so beautiful.
Man, that would have been really cool. That would have been fun. Yes, absolutely. Well, welcome to the program. Tell everyone who you are. Just a random guy sitting here beside me this morning.
Yeah, well, I'm not. I would almost like to say I'm her new co-host, but I can't hold a candle to that one.
Didn't you know?
Well, my name's Brian Rau, and I am been voted as the next superintendent, or approved as the next superintendent at Wellston City Schools.
Yes.
So I'm just excited. I mean, I'm just humbled and excited to be the next superintendent at Wellston.
So yes, this fella is pumped and ready to take on the new role. So we were talking off the air, though. This has to be a really stressful time for you because you're finishing up what you're doing now, yet preparing for your new job. So you're doing like kind of double duty right now.
It is a little bit of a back and forth and kind of a time management, and just you got to make sure that, yes, I'm still employed by Manchester Local Schools in Adams County. So I'm still the superintendent there until the end of July, and then really just transition right into Wellston. So fortunately, I mean, Wellston's got so many great things in place already with the staff and everything else. I'm meeting with some board members today. Not together, though. We don't want to break the sunshine laws. But we are meeting with – I'm meeting with some board members today, and I'll have some meetings set up with some of the administrators so we can get a feel for what's going on in the summer, because you're right. I still have to maintain what we're doing at Manchester, and I have to work with the incoming superintendent with that transition.
You don't just throw them to the wolves, right?
Exactly. You can't do that. So it is a bit of a balancing act, but we'll get it. We'll get it.
I have faith that you will. All right, so let's back up for a minute and talk about your life and where you're from and a little bit about your education and that kind of thing.
Yes, absolutely. I am married to, and I don't want to go too much into it because I'll start shedding tears. But I'm married to an amazing, amazing woman. I refer to her as my angel sent from heaven, and I truly believe she is.
No wonder you're still married.
And we've been friends for quite a while, even before we was married. So, collectively, we have four children and one beautiful granddaughter. I graduated from Eastern Brown, and that's in Brown County, not Eastern Beaver. Okay. So there are so many Easterns out there.
Yeah, there's a lot of Easterns.
I graduated from Eastern Brown, went to Morehead State University for my bachelor's degree, master's degree at University of Dayton. superintendent license at the University of the Cumberlands, and at University of Cumberlands, where I also got I obtained my doctorate in leadership as well.
Okay.
So I started my career many years ago at Fayetteville Middle School in Brown County, and absolutely love that area. After that, went in the military. I lived in Sicily for 4 years, and I could just go on and on about that.
Okay, that's a whole other
that's a whole nother show. So once I finally got back into education, was it employed at Ripley Union Lewis Huntington Schools. That's a mouthful.
What?
And that's Southern.
I feel sorry for the receptionist that has to answer all the
applications that you have to write. It's like, oh my gosh. So I was a seventh grade math teacher there.
Okay.
And I was there for 4 years until I went to Manchester. And I've been at Manchester for the last 12 years with a variety of positions there. I was hired in as elementary assistant principal and district special education coordinator. And then I jumped up to elementary principal. Then I went to director of special programs and director of curriculum.
Okay.
And then then the last 5 years as superintendent. So I've had a wealth of experience and a wealth of positions. So I feel like I can bring a lot to Wellston just for what I have done, just even my time at Manchester, and just eternally grateful for what they've been able to provide for me.
Well, don't you think, and I'm not putting words in your mouth, I guess it's just a question, you know, starting as a teacher and going through all the different facets of the education program or education in general, it would have to make for a better superintendent because you understand what the teachers are going through, what the students are going through, and the parents, and, you know, you understand all of that.
There is a caveat.
Okay.
And you're exactly right. If you do not forget where you came from.
Heard.
There are too many. I mean, we've all seen them. You know, some people go up into the administrative ranks, and superintendent as well, they want a title. That title doesn't obligate you to do anything except you get more stress and more issues come your way. That's really all it is. You know, I've always said I didn't come from the teacher realm. I came from the substitute teacher realm. So I started as a substitute teacher, and I've never forgotten that.
Right.
So, and that's what a lot of folks kind of fail to realize today. And I'm not saying I shouldn't say a lot, but there's a percentage of folks out there that they see the title. And, you know, that doesn't make you any better than anybody else. And, you know, that's what I've tried to convey to folks is I'm just an ordinary person. I'm no different. I'm no different than the next person walking down the street. It's just this is the profession I chose, and this is where I'm at.
Hey, can I interject here real quick? Last night I had a teenager that was working at Save-A-Lot tell me I look like his substitute teacher.
What does a substitute teacher look like?
I tell you.
He's like, you look familiar. Where do I know you from? I was like, I don't know. He's like, you look like a substitute teacher.
You need to embrace that. You know, I was sitting, here's a story, Ro, and I know I'm getting off topic.
We've got an hour. You're good. Or 40 minutes or whatever.
So I'm sitting in the dentist, not chair, because it's, you know, you lean, it's more of a couch. And the lady cleaning my teeth. And I'd been that dentist, I mean, all my life.
Sure.
But she didn't know who I was. And I told her I worked for the school. So when I tell people what I do, I don't tell them that I'm a superintendent. Not that I'm ashamed of it, because as soon as they hear you're a superintendent, they treat you differently.
Yeah.
I don't want to be treated differently.
Sure.
So I just told her I worked at the school, and she just kept going and going. And very, very nicely. I mean, it wasn't rude. And finally, she just said, well, are you the custodian? And I said, ma'am, I was like, I couldn't do their job. I have so much respect for our custodial staff, our maintenance staff, and all those support individuals. I said, I couldn't do it. Then I had to end up telling her what I did. And then she felt bad. I was like, why do you feel bad? I was like, that was a huge compliment being told I was a custodian. But no, I couldn't.
No doubt.
So yeah, so I've gotten, you know, I've same, you know, not the substitute teacher, but yeah, I've been told I was a custodian. And I loved it. I loved it.
Absolutely. I'd be proud to be.
Absolutely.
That's awesome. Because they do a lot.
I can't.
You have to know everything about everything and all the inner workings of the school and all the kids.
They're amazing.
And yeah, that's a whole other story. All right. So you have definitely been around the block a time or two, a couple years. Is what we say here. We don't ever say we're old here.
That's fine.
Everything was a couple years or a few years ago.
I like a couple.
Just to let you know. Yeah. So, Adams County, you've been there for quite quite some time then, about 12 years, you said?
Been Adams County total 12 years. And I was familiar with Adams County. I was familiar with Manchester. I had a lot of friends growing up from the bowling alley and, of course, rivals. And I've always told my friends at Eastern, I said, you're not allowed to make fun of people from Manchester. Now, I can because I have friends down there. I'm not letting you make fun of people. So I was very familiar with Manchester and familiar with the area. So good. It's not like when I went to Manchester, I didn't have to really learn anything. But the one thing I got, and I'll say one of the biggest, I shouldn't say biggest, one of the greatest accomplishments that I think I've had, or not I think, this is one of the greatest accomplishments to me that I've had while at Manchester. Sure. Is I think it was in I can't remember how many years of superintendent, maybe the first or second year of superintendent. But I'd been with the district several years prior and kind of moved up. But I know when the Manchester High School Alumni Association unanimously voted me in as an honorary alum, that just cemented the fact that I am a member of the community. And that's what I've tried to tell folks here is, no, I'm not from Wellston, but I can assure you that I'm going to be embedded within that community. And I'm not looking for no recognition. I am not in this business for any recognition, accolades, thank yous. I don't want any awards. I don't want any of that stuff. You know, I'm just here to do my job. But when I was voted as an alum of Manchester, that really cemented the place in the community.
Very good. Now, as superintendent, do you need to move into the community?
I've spoken with the board. I actually have a place already.
Oh, okay.
So I don't want to say too much about that.
No, we won't tell anyone what's your address? No, I'm just
Well, I will say, when I say it's a small little apartment, and you shouldn't really, I guess, put two of those little adjectives together, but it is a very small and it's very little, but it's everything.
No, it's quaint.
It's
charming.
It's very, very quaint. But that's all I need. I'm going to be at the school events, the community. I'm going to be there basically to lay my head. So this is just my opinion. Others think it differently. You know, I was asked in an interview, you know, is it important to live in the district?
Sure.
And I was very candid. You know, I don't like to tell people what I think they want to hear. I'll tell them, we spoke.
Yeah, we had this conversation already.
If you're going to ask me a question, and be prepared for my response.
Yeah.
Is I don't think it's as important to live in the community as much as you are immersed in the community.
Sure.
Because I can live in the community and be a recluse and never, ever come out.
Right.
And what good's that do anybody? So I would rather be seen in the community. And, you know, it's kind of, you know, the place I'm at right now, it's good to know people. I had a friend that has a best friend and owns some things, and that's kind of how I got hooked up with this one.
With your charming apartment?
Very charming. And I tell people, it's like, don't come to, we're not going to have a housewarming party. It's like a room warming party, but I can only invite three people, so.
One of them has to sit in the bathroom. That's funny. No, well, that's good. No, welcome to the community. We're so happy to have you here. So, well, let's just talk about it. You know, what are you looking forward to? What are some of your goals? That kind of thing, you know, moving forward for Wellston. I think that the Wellston City School District, in my opinion, has been phenomenal as of late. So a lot of great teachers there, things like that. So what are you thinking that you're going to work toward first, or?
Well, here's what I have told everybody that's asked that similar question. Mm-hmm. Is the first thing I would love for the community of the city of Wellston and the Wellston City's Board of Education and the staff to be able to say, man, in 30 years, we had two superintendents plus a stint with an interim. I mean, I'm not a job jumper, and you can look at my history. I don't jump from job to job. This isn't a stepping stone job for me. So if I'm committed, and I'm a very loyal to where I am.
Okay.
So my first thing is, and I take that seriously, because what I say, it's just not a 1 year time off or a one contract and you're gone. And okay, yeah, you're gonna look for a bigger school. I'm not into all that stuff.
Uh-huh.
You know, when my wife and I came here. And I'm going to answer your question here in a second.
No, but you're fine.
When my wife and I, when we came for the meet and greet, and you know, they voted, you know, all that, when we left, we both said the same thing is, man, we felt so much at home there.
Mm-hmm.
And that was just, the people were so welcoming. I mean, it was unbelievable. I mean, it truly was
good. Unbelievable.
So, and this is what I've told folks. You know, I've known Mrs. Boch for 5 years because we served on a committee together at State Department.
Okay.
So at BASA. I'm sorry, not really State Department, but BASA. So, and I knew that hearing her, the great things that Wellston was doing with her, with Karen.
Yes.
And then I know that Marianne has maintained that with her stint here.
Sure.
So a lot of people says, what's your vision for Wellston? Well, the board sets the vision, meaning the actual vision. You know, I want to come in and I don't want to change anything great that they're doing. Mm-hmm. I mean, if it's great, you can build on it, but don't change it. So I don't want to come in and do all this and change, you know, build on what we've got. You know, I was walking around the district a few Saturdays ago, whenever it snowed terrible here. I don't know when it was.
Every day.
Oh my gosh. And I actually called to say how are the roads, because I was having my final interview on that Monday.
Okay.
And so I wanted to come up incognito. Nobody knew who I was. And it was luckily it was cold because I had my coat on, my toboggan. Nobody knew me. I didn't shave. I was miserable looking. But I went around and I talked to so many people, and uh-huh. they were so kind and they were so honest with their answers. Now, if I would have told them that, I've got a final interview for the superintendent, I would not have got those candid sure. responses. So I went and just started introducing myself. I never gave him my last name. I said, hey, I'm Brian. Hey, I'm looking to move into the area and looking at schools. That's really not a lie. So I didn't lie.
That's true.
So, and what I found out is something that I kind of already had heard is, you know, the greatest strengths of the school district are the students and the staff. Mm-hmm. And that includes all the staff from the yep. administrators on down to the support staff and the contracted staff. So, you know, once I heard that, that really cemented my thoughts is, oh my gosh, this is going to be a phenomenal experience. And I truly mean that.
That's awesome.
So what I do hope to bring to Wellston is, one, my experience that I've had with a lot of aspects of education. But and I've, you know, I facilitated the district leadership team for a while, so I understand strategic planning and I understand all that stuff, all the big words that people want to hear.
Right.
But I just want to continue the great things that Wellston has done. And, you know, one of the things I told this the morning show, and I'm probably going to get kicked out of here. And I have so much respect for any public school district or definitely any superintendent, because these jobs are not easy.
Oh, no, they are not. And they're thankless.
Oh, gosh. And again, they are. Almost like an athletic director. That's a very thankless job, too.
Yes.
But we have – but one of the things that the people that I spoke with, and I explained this to the board when I did this SWOT analysis for them for my final interview – is one of the concern. Now, I don't want to say it's a concern, but one of the topics that was kind of revolving with everyone. It was almost in common that everyone says, okay, well, Jackson City has a little bit more of this than what Wellston does, meaning on the curriculum piece. So, and I took that, and you know, this is something that I'm going to look into. Mm-hmm. And I don't think it's as much that we're doing anything different or what Wellston's doing anything different. A lot of it, I think, could be a mindset, because from what I've gathered from some folks that I've spoken with is we need to instill that confidence back in us at Wellston that
sure.
we are Wellston.
Yeah. You know,
Wellston is a phenomenal school district. I talked to a couple people that had graduated from Wellston. Oh my gosh, their experiences were remarkable. Mm-hmm. Now I know what everybody's different. I get that. But those are the things that I'm looking forward to just getting in there and just rolling the sleeves up and getting to work.
Love that. I love to hear that. And, you know, your enthusiasm is infectious, and we're so glad to have you in the area, because, you know, if you have somebody that just comes in and is like,
and I'm here,
it's kind of hard to get motivated.
Well, I can't. and there's going to be some out there saying, oh, he's just hamming it up for the radio or that. Nah, that for the who you see is who you are. I mean, yeah. I don't pretend to be somebody I'm not. And sometimes my wife will, I'm a morning person, which is great as on the morning show and then here. I'm a morning guy. My wife, not so much. So you can imagine something is, I'm just one of those folks. I love life. I try to take advantage of every opportunity that's given.
I think that's a wonderful thing. So thank you. Yeah, that's great. All right. Let's see. Do we have any questions or anything, James?
No questions yet. I mean, there are a few people that want to know about your opinion on Bigfoot, but that's really just
Jen and me. we'll get to that. We will. You just tell me. You mean to answer that now?
Yeah.
No, I mean, you don't have to. Jennifer just asked me if I had any questions. I couldn't think of anything
now,
else
listen,
to say.
Hey, we started this on Wednesday with the Bigfoot researcher here on the show.
I can't top that.
Yeah, it's pretty tough. So then we had yesterday our game warden on. Ted, so we nailed him with the Bigfoot questions. So, I mean, it's only fair game to continue on the week with another Bigfoot question.
Here is and
have you or have you not encountered a Bigfoot?
I have not. Personally, I have not. But I will say that I got to watch what I say, because if my son were to Google this and this would come up. Now, he's older now, so maybe he's a little bit more intelligent than what he was back when 10 years ago. But my dad was going to take my son and my nephew out for a Bigfoot hunt one time, because they were just, both of those two are enthralled with Bigfoot. My son loves finding Bigfoot. Now, I don't know if he still watches it, because I've not asked him, but now I'm going to have to ask him.
Now you need to know. And
now
if
I have to know.
We need to know.
So we had this plan cooked up, and I was going to buy this elaborate suit. Of course, I can use it for Halloween, whatever. And my dad lives, we're in a field, you could look way far away. So he said, here's what we'll do. One more, we'll make it kind of dusk to where you can't really see good. But he's like, we'll take him out there. And then dad said that, you know, I'll just start going crazy. And these kids, they were young at the time. So I don't know. They may have needed some underdrawers after we had done that, because we had it plotted.
They're now scarred for life.
We didn't do it. We didn't get a chance to do it, because I was probably too cheap to buy the outfit. But that was the plan we always had. So hearing about Bigfoot,
that
my son and nephew, they would eat this alive. So I got to really watch what I say, because I don't want to dampen what they believe.
Yeah, you don't want to, you know, damage their psyche or their it.
But I've never seen one. I have personally never seen one.
So do you or do you not think that there may be a chance that there's a Bigfoot out there?
There's always a chance of anything. If somebody would have told me,
never say never,
Brian, in a year from now, you're going to be the superintendent at Wellston, I would have laughed at him and said, thank you and move on. there, anything is possible.
Hey, there you go. So now you know. You really have gotten to know this guy now.
I could tell you. I better just zip it.
No, we had a lot of fun with the Bigfoot folks, and it's pretty cool to hear, you know, some of their adventures, because they've been on some adventures.
I do like ghost hunting.
Now, that is one that I would definitely agree with. There are some weird, things that happen out there in the world.
And that's for another topic for another day, but I have all the gear my wife and I love. Now, we do not go often. It's been a few years since we have went, but she's experienced a couple weird things. And in fact, my brother and I, we've done the same thing. And so that stuff does intrigue me.
I think there's so much out there, and I don't know, you know, no one knows what it is, but we've all had strange things happen to us. You know, things that you shouldn't know, or you've been there before, or I mean, there's all kind of weird stuff that happens that I don't know if it's our brains are probably have a lot more capability than we're able to harness, would be my guess.
I would say much more.
Yeah. But we're just where we're at. All right. So, and we digress again. I don't know.
How do we transition from that?
So let's talk about the schools in general up in Wellston, and, you know, the sports programs and all of that. How are you feeling? Like they're in good shape, or are there, you know, some infrastructure things or anything like that that y'all are going to have to work on coming up?
That's a question I will have to find out, because I don't want to sit here and say, oh yeah, we're all perfect. That's one thing I have not checked on. I did speak with the athletic director at the meet and greet. I think it's Jeff. Uh-huh. I'm terrible with names, so if I forget names, folks, I'm sorry. I'm awful. Pretty good with faces, awful with names. But he and I spoke, and I've actually emailed him a couple different times. So I've not heard of any major issues coming
good.
Up.
Good. I mean, that's a good thing.
Yeah, but that doesn't mean that there's not something in the weeds somewhere. But I'll try to sort some of that out before I get to August. You know, the one thing I did tell the board during my interview is being hired at the end of March, or at least having board approved at the end of March.
Sure.
You have April, May, June, and July. There's so many things you could be doing. And it's true, I still have another district to run in Manchester.
Yes.
But I have to take advantage of this time, which is come up here talking to you guys, and take advantage of meeting all these stakeholders and all the people and all that. So in that 4-month span, you know, I've got a list of folks that I would like to already meet. So when August the 1st, or actually I do have a 10-day transition contract. So I'll be starting here actually the second week of July. I think that's what I have it worked out.
Okay.
But August 1st officially. There's so much work you can do between April and August 1.
Sure.
So that's why I'm trying to lay some of this groundwork now. So when August 1st rolls around, is you hit the ground running and you don't need to be, you're already ready and you already know what's going on. Sure. So you're ready for all that stuff. But those are things I'll be looking into.
Man. And, so in the meantime, you're having to train someone else at your school district because you can't leave them hanging.
I am fortunate in the sense that my replacement, it's always nice. You're always in this position. They've always said, the best case scenario is you're always training your replacement. And I know that sounds bad because I can't really stand sports analogies.
Listen, but that's good in a way and bad sometimes. Sometimes good, sometimes bad.
I know. And we all have seen it in sports. Somebody's hurt, somebody steps up. That's just what it is. But I'm very fortunate that our current elementary principal has been approved as this next superintendent at Manchester.
Oh my gosh.
So that transition has made it easier. Now he's a little bit less experienced on some of the things that I have done, mm-hmm. but we're getting that worked out and I'm doing everything possible. He kind of jokes and says, now when you leave, he's like, please don't delete my number.
I was like, nah. Please answer my call.
Yeah, don't worry. So no, we work very well together. I have much respect for him.
Good.
So that transition in and of itself is not bad, but he does have some positions he has to fill. And unfortunately, that's kind of on him because he doesn't, I shouldn't be the one filling his positions because maybe I'll select somebody he might not want.
Right.
And those type of things. So yeah, we've worked together great and that transition won't be as bad. So that's why I'm trying to, get him up to speed as much as I can so I can spend as much time with Wellston.
Wonderful. And the great thing is, you know Karen Boch, mm-hmm. The current kind of interim mm-hmm. superintendent. So again, you have that person that you can go to to ask opinions and all that.
And what's weird, that's what I was telling the morning show folks, and in all honesty, is like, this is going to be a new experience for me, not just because it's Wellston and, it's Wellston's definitely different to Manchester. It's much bigger than Manchester. The community and the school. But at Manchester, I wear so many hats because I do not have an administrator that took care of all the things that I used to do. So I had to continue to do them.
I see.
And there's the whole long story that we won't get into that. But here at Wellston, all the things that I do at Manchester, the infrastructure here is so great that there are folks in those positions that does it. So this is honest to God, this is the first time that I'm actually going to get to be a superintendent instead of the testing coordinator, the special education director, the state federal programs coordinator. So I'll get to, I might have to go back to school to learn how to be a superintendent because this is the first time I'm actually going to get to be a superintendent, like, and not everything else.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
That's exciting.
That would be. Yeah. Absolutely.
Which is one of the reasons why this position intrigued me.
Good. Mm-hmm. Well, that is amazing. All right. So what would be some of the differences between the school district that you're coming from to the one that you're going to?
Most of it is, honestly, it's the size.
Yeah.
I mean, Wellston is over double the size of where I'm at now.
Is it really?
Mm-hmm. It's,
wow.
Yeah. The community in and of itself, just the amount of the businesses and industry that's here in Wellston is much different. But students are students.
Yes.
I won't get into this one because I've always said a 5-year-old brain is still a 5-year-old brain, but they still want us to teach algebra now in kindergarten. I'm kind of exaggerating on that one. But
close.
Yeah. So you know where I'm coming from. But a lot of the differences in and of itself is just, one is the financial piece to it. We lost, and I'm not going to get into a whole bunch of this because this will take 2 hours in and of itself.
Sure.
We lost two coal power plants the summer that I took over as superintendent.
Oh, no.
So I lost almost a quarter of my operating budget. I had to lay off so many people.
Wow.
And I actually had to lay off administration. I mean, it was across the board, administration, teachers, support staff. So I was in a bad predicament right off the bat. So with that, we all had to wear different hats.
Oh,
so again, the truly the big difference is I'm coming up to And we manage. I mean, right now we've got, you know, a $6+ million carryover where 2 years ago, a year and a half from now, we were supposed to be flat broke. So
good for you. So hey, that pays homage to the district.
We did what we had to do, made a lot of people upset because when you make those decisions, people lose jobs. I mean, it was a terrible time with the financial piece of it. But that brings into play the infrastructure that we was talking about earlier with the administration. You know, the schools. Manchester's on one campus, and we have a pre-K 6 building. You walk down the hall, then you're in a 712 building.
Okay.
So it's all in one thing.
That's it.
Right. My office is right off of the cafeteria of the high school. So you talk about accessible and open door policy, and I'm okay with that. That, you know, you just get used to it. There is no privacy.
Wow.
And my office is about as big as the desk we're sitting in almost. It seems like if you put a square here. But coming here to Wellston, I mean, oh my gosh. When we first drove up here that day that I was incognito, we drove the campus, or we didn't, I've not been to Bundy.
Okay.
So well, full disclosure, I've not been to Bundy. We went to the campus out of town, mm-hmm. and we're driving down the road, and my granddaughter's like, this looks like we're driving into a rich person's place.
Aww.
And it's like, it does, because they're immaculate. They're just beautiful facilities.
Yeah.
So, I mean, you've got, you know, instead of just one school for the elementary and one school for the junior high school, and of course, Wellston, you've got four schools, and I love that. So, I mean, and there's just so many things that I just can't wait to take advantage of that. And I hope that people here at Wellston do not take for granted what they have. You know, I've come from nothing, and I love Manchester. I have a lot of love for Manchester, the village of Manchester, Manchester local school district, and all the staff and the students and families and that kind of thing. But you guys have some immaculate facilities.
We're blessed.
And blessed is a great word. And I hope that people just don't take that for granted.
Hey, that's part of your job. Don't let them.
Exactly. And you can hold me to that.
So what is this that I have heard about you playing the saxophone?
That seems to be picking up some steam.
Yeah. How does everybody know that?
I'm not even going to, again, if you do not want to know the answer, do not ask the question.
Are you are you not the next Kenny G?
No.
Okay.
Kenny G is in another stratosphere.
There's the saxophone, and then there's like Kenny G.
Someone always called me, oh my gosh, what's his name? Of course, he's passed away now. He always called me a name, and I can't remember the name he called me. But I played the saxophone. I played alto saxophone from... In fact, I was small. The only reason I chose the saxophone in the fifth grade is that was the coolest looking instrument that I had. I was like, who wants to play a trumpet? It's only got three things, you know, three vowels. I want something that has a bunch of keys. But little did I know, the saxophone was about half my size.
Yes.
So I played saxophone from fifth grade until through my sophomore year in high school. I switched to tenor sax, and I love tenor sax. I love the tenor sax. So I played tenor sax my junior and senior year, and I was actually conned, and I'm going to say conned, into playing the bassoon 1 year in concert band. That was quite the experience. And then I played and then I played alto sax again 1 year, one semester of marching band in college. Uh-huh. So I still played it. Several years later, I ended up purchasing a saxophone and went back to playing it. So I play a lot in church. And actually, the very first time I played it in public, and I did this to show the kids that it's okay to mess up and look like a fool, and people's going to make fun of you, and that's just what it is. But it was Thanksgiving. Oh my gosh, I was the principal, so it was either in 2011, maybe 2011 or 12, I can't remember. But I took my book, and I did practice a little bit because I didn't want to go in there with nothing.
Sure.
And then I played all kinds of Christmas songs and just anything I could find. I messed up so many times, but I made an announcement because I did that during the morning breakfast.
Uh-huh.
And I told the kids, I was like, you know, I'm doing this. People's going to laugh at me because I'm going to mess up quite a bit. But it's okay. Just keep going. And it's okay to just make sure you are true to who you are. And that was kind of the message.
Sure.
So I did that during morning breakfast. And then from there, it just kind of took off.
Well, hey, there you go. A saxophone playing superintendent.
Hey, I played saxophone in high school marching band too.
Did you?
Yeah.
I'm like, oh my gosh. See, you and James can do a duet.
Unlike Josh Will, yeah, I think who I've, played I'm that like, trumpet.
Yeah, he played that stupid thing with only the three keys. It's not hard.
I mean, it's something I just always like to do. And luckily I still remember how to play the thing. So
that's good. See, there you go. Something new. You learn something new every day.
When I heard Wellston had and somebody told me this, Wellston. When I was incognito, I stopped to eat at La Rosa. I love La Rosa. That place will be taking a lot of my money probably. So when I stopped in there, the girl that waited on us, I told my wife, I'm just going to ask him. She said, don't do that, Brian. And I said, it's okay. So I said, I'm just going to ask you a question. She's like, where'd you graduate? And she looked at me like, basically, why do you want to know?
Yeah.
I was like who? They didn't know me. So they said, Wellston. I was like, oh my gosh, you got to be kidding me. And I was like, well, tell me about Wellston. I still didn't tell her who I was.
Yeah.
And then she was going on, and one of the things she said was the band was great.
Yes.
And I'm thinking, and I went home that next day. I actually called one of my best friends who's also a saxophone player, and we went to school together. And I said, man, Brady, you're not going to believe this. I was like, Wellston's got a great band. I was like, oh, man, I'm just excited. Between the band and the bowling team, I mean, I just hit gold here.
Love that. That's awesome.
Hey, speaking of things that Wellston is really good at, have you had a chance to check out their softball team yet?
Oh my gosh, these girls are just...
I have not.
Get out of their way, man.
In fact, when I was talking to Jeff, the AD, I asked him to make sure he lets me know when the tournament games start. It's just very hard for me because I don't think I would ever get up here in time to watch a game because of when they start, because I would have to even leave work early, and that looks pretty bad when somebody's paying you or leaving work to. So it is hard for me to come up to watch any of the spring sports.
Uh-huh.
But I did ask him to let me know when the tournament starts because I do want to go watch the beginning of their tournament.
Lots of talented kids here. In
this young lady threw a no hitter last week.
Really? I can't wait to see that.
I mean.
And much respect for those pitchers in softball.
Those girls are insane.
I couldn't hit it.
So good. All right. Well, is there anything else you would like to tell our viewers while you're here?
It's amazing how quickly 40 minutes goes by.
Isn't it?
I'm thinking we just started. So there's like lots. You know, I just really appreciate the warm welcome that you guys have given me.
Well, of course.
That Wellston has given me. And Jackson County in general, I mean, it's just, it is overwhelming. And I'm one of those types of folks, I don't like to be the spotlight. You know, I do because I'm talking about the school. But when it's about me, I don't make it about me. I'm not comfortable with that.
Heard.
But I hope this isn't the last time we get a chance to do this.
Absolutely not.
And we've got other things to talk about.
Yes, we do.
But no, I really appreciate the hospitality and just the warm welcome that everyone here has given me. I mean, this is it really is overwhelming and it's very humbling and I am so much appreciative.
Well, we hillbillies down here do something right. We're very hospitable.
I'm one of the hillbillies too.
All right. We got a pretty important question here from Rick.
Okay.
Have you had a Jackson County veal and a ski pop yet?
Oh, that is a fantastic question.
Well, I'm going to have to say no because I might have to ask what exactly was the question again?
Jackson County veal, what also known as Wellston veal, which is like a fried pork sandwich.
I have not.
And ski pop is kind of like Mellow Yellow.
I know what that is. I do know what that is. I do know what that is.
On crack.
I have not.
Well, let's just say if you have something very important to do, don't drink a ski pop if you don't know how it affects you.
Okay, I will remember that.
Because it is like speed in a bottle. There's a little bit of sugar in it, just a little bit.
When I was the assistant principal, my principal used to call me Flash because I just would not slow down. I don't know if I need that. I don't drink caffeine.
Oh,
so, hold on. Let me rephrase that. I don't drink coffee in the morning. Now, occasionally, I'll drink Coke or Pepsi or some of that stuff. But I might be crashing off the walls.
Actually, no. I'll tell you what. We need to bring him back in. We'll give him a ski beginning of the show.
We don't have any ski, but we have some of those Baya energy drinks left in there.
No, we'll give you a ski before the beginning of the show, and then then we'll interview you, and we'll see how it ends.
Do I have to sign some kind of medical agreement?
Probably. No, when you hear Jackson County veal, just to let you know, okay, this is something that you will learn.
Oh, cool.
It is a sandwich that's very well known around our area, and people think veal. Oh, I'm not eating veal because veal
I like
scandalous.
Veal. I like veal.
But a Jackson County veal is a very thinly pounded out pork tenderloin, breaded and deep fried.
I am going to check that out.
I choose to eat mine with mustard and pickle, but other people choose to eat them any variety of ways. And the bun is here and the veal is like here.
That
so you have
like
to eat around
the bone before you get to it.
Yeah.
That sounds like my kind of sandwich.
I mean, there's definitely ways. Like, I was having lunch with a friend the other day, and we had veals, and she tore the pieces off and put it on the bun. But I just eat around.
Interesting.
So, yeah. Just depends.
Oh, I will be checking.
There you go.
I will absolutely look into this.
And they're not hard to find because a lot of people have them. All right. Well, let's get to the cycle search clue, and we'll make you read the cycle search clue for today.
No, okay. Great.
And this is really good because it's basically these clues are getting good now. So
yeah, somebody doesn't find it by like next Tuesday or Wednesday.
Yeah, I don't know what to tell you. Yep. It'll probably be found this weekend would be my guess.
So what's the background on this, if you don't mind me asking?
Okay, so Total Media and Honda Suzuki Polaris Can-Am of Jackson. One lucky listener will win a KO2, that bike that was just up there, mm-hmm, KO250 dirt bike with an accessories package. And the clue today is brought to you by Jenkins Care Community and Max Residential Heating and Cooling. So since when did we start, James?
You mean this year or like the history of the
cycle search? No, this year.
It started on Valentine's Day this year.
So on Valentine's Day, we started doing a daily clue. So listeners have to listen every day for the clue. You have to write them down. You have to remember. And so you have to start putting all the clues together.
Okay.
And then somewhere hidden is a key packet to that.
Ooh, that's interesting.
So people go out and they hunt and they look and whatever. And it's hidden somewhere in our listening area.
Man, so I'm a Honda guy, so I like this.
Oh, well, here you go.
You're in luck because you're here on a day that the clues are starting to
actually tells
good.
You something. Okay, so I need you to read the Friday clue, one. Yes.
The Friday, the 4/15.
Yep.
I do not want to read the Monday, 4/18.
No, do not do that.
All right, Friday, 4/15. This is the clue. Let's recap today. Vinton, billboard, highway. These three are all part of where the key shall be. Again, let's recap today. Vinton, billboard, highway. These three are all part of where the key shall be.
So we're getting down to the nitty gritty now.
That's pretty specific.
I mean, that's telling you. Vinton, billboard, highway.
That's pretty specific.
Just saying.
And folks out there, whoever wins that bike, do not forget who gave you that clue.
If you find that bike, you better be, it's the Wellston superintendent.
We'll go out for a ride together.
That's right. All right. Well, thank you so much for coming in and best of luck to you. And come and see us before you start.
I will. This has been great.
We'll
give you
a ski pop. It'll be fantastic.
I'll bring my wife to drive me back too.
There you go. It's not quite, it's not like alcohol.
Well,
but
they do make that alcoholic ski, remember?
They do make alcoholic ski, which is
nobody
which is so bad that you can't even, I can't even fathom how to even explain how bad it is.
Weren't they like redoing that? Because people disliked the first version so much, they were like doing a Mach 2 version to try to make it better.
I don't know how you can, but
to each their own.
It was called Brewski, and it was alcoholic ski.
Yeah. Now pass.
Yeah. Anyway, I digress again.
Well, thank you so much.
Oh, thank you for being here. So we actually had the pleasure of meeting Ohio's First Lady, Fran DeWine.
Yes, yeah.
She came to Jackson the other day to Elizabeth's Hope, and she was kind enough to take time out of her day because she was traveling to several different places to allow us an interview. So James, thanks to James for slicing and dicing and doing all the things that James does, which is like magic. Put together a little video. So we're going to hear about Elizabeth's Hope, what they do, and also some of the exciting things that our First Lady is doing and where she's looking for in the future.
And so we've done some of that work with her with Imagination Library.
Yes, and that's what you'll be talking with her about that. Yeah. So let's head there, and we will see you all on Monday. Thanks for watching.
Well, hello, everyone, and we are here with the First Lady of the State of Ohio, Ms. Fran DeWine. Thank you for taking time to talk with us today.
It's so good to be here. Thank you.
Wonderful. And again, we are at Elizabeth's Hope and a wonderful facility here in Jackson. We're so proud of it, and thank you for taking the time to
It's been amazing just to go through it and see the wonderful women who work here. So,
absolutely. Yes, absolutely.
I'm really impressed.
Yes. All right. Well, so you have some initiatives that you work. Obviously, the governor does his thing. As First Lady, you do your thing.
And I get to do my thing, which I love. And, you know, I love children.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we're the parents of 8 children, and we have 26 grandkids now.
So, oh, my goodness.
What I think about is kids. But actually, I was with a couple of my grandkids several years ago,
mm-hmm.
and they got their mail. And in the mail came these 2 books, one for each of them, all wrapped in plastic, and they, you know, addressed to them, and they ripped off the plastic, and read to me, Grandma. And I saw what a great thing this was. And so I did my research and found out about the Imagination Library, Dolly Parton's Imagination Library.
Love her and that.
Exactly. And at that time, it was in a few places in Ohio, but not everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
And so when Mike was elected, I thought, that's what I want to do. I want to make this available for every single child in Ohio. And so we've made it available every single child in Ohio, no matter where they live, from the time they're born until they turn 5 years old, can sign up to get a free book in the mail every single month.
Every month?
Every month.
That is amazing.
So if we get them signed up when they're first born, then they'll get 60 books before they turn 5 years old.
Isn't that amazing?
So it's amazing. And they're fun books.
They are. And you know, I can remember some of my favorite parts of being a child were people reading to me. So
right.
It's still a thing.
And there's so many important reasons why we should do it.
Yes.
You know, I mean, first of all, a child's brain is 80% developed by the time they're 3 years old.
Wow.
And so we can't waste those early years, you know. That's so important. And, you know, there's been some studies done. Cincinnati Children's Hospital did a study. It showed that after these kids got these books for 3 years, their kindergarten readiness score came up 14 points. And so they were really even with everybody else. And so you can imagine, if your child starts kindergarten and he's even with everybody else and mm-hmm. he's not behind, he's got a much better chance of success. And so those are just some of the reasons why I love doing it. Besides, it's fun.
Exactly. And, you know, over the past couple of years, don't we just need some fun?
We need some fun.
We definitely
do. A good thing during the pandemic is that these kids were getting their books. You know, a lot of times our libraries were closed, our preschools were closed, but they were at least getting their books in the mail. So
it gives them something to look forward to.
Yeah, and it's addressed to them. I was always concerned because, you know, they're always age appropriate. So different, you have many kids, they'll get many books, different mm-hmm. books. But twins, because they're age, you know, they're going to get the same one. But I talked to a mother a couple of nights ago who had twins, and she said, this is the greatest thing because they both get the same book, and it's got their name on it, and there's no fighting about who's it is.
We don't share, and I like that.
So anyway, so it's good, yes.
Very, very good. Well, speaking of, you know, oh, goodness, we've all survived this pandemic thing, and, you know, being governor and the First Lady is hard enough. Let alone having to do that during a global pandemic. So I know that you probably haven't gotten to do all of the things that you were hoping to as the First Lady of the state of Ohio. So what are some of the things that you're looking forward to moving forward now that we're able to get out and about a little bit?
Well, with the Imagination Library, we're up to 44% of kids signed up
really?
In the state, and I think this county is a stellar county. We're at 50%.
Yay!
So, so that's good. So I'm going to continue to work on that. We have more kids getting the books in Ohio than any other state. We're not as high a percentage as like Tennessee is at 70, and we're at 44.
That makes sense. That's where Dolly's at.
But that's right. But we're building our way up, and we have more kids getting the books here now. So
go us.
So yeah, so that's good. So I'm going to continue working on that.
Wonderful.
And, you know, I also like, you know, to work on just you know, food. I love to cook.
I heard that about you.
I made a few cookbooks.
Yes, I have one, actually.
Yes, and actually I made one for the Dolly Parton Imagination Library.
Great.
Which has Dolly's recipes and mine, and it's a way on the back to sign your kids up for the Imagination Library. So I'll share those with you, too. So.
Perfect.
But, you know, I like to teach kids where their food came from.
That's great.
And, you know, I'll be doing some things at the state fair. And I also do some things at the governor's residence. You know, we have gardens there, and we'll bring school children in, and we'll let them make pizza and, you know, pick their own vegetables and chop them and put them on the pizza and serve lunches, things like that.
You know, that's so fun to get the kids. I know when they get to participate in cooking their own food, they're more apt to try things, too.
Absolutely.
So that's fantastic.
I like them to know where the food comes from. And
yes.
So I have, you know, we live on a farm, even though we don't farm it, but our farmer brings us a couple of big buckets of wheat when they have wheat harvest.
Mm-hmm.
And so I have a little hand grinder that we got our kids years and years ago. And so I love to let the kids, I like to show them the wheat, let them feel it.
Yes.
And then grind it. And especially little boys, all they want to do is grind wheat all day long. But then we make it into dough. And we talk
That's
about
amazing.
The yeast that makes it rise and all those things. So I just like to do that, you know, so that they understand food and where it comes from. And you know, I think that's important. And I also like to help with food insecurity, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I was at a place in northeast Ohio the other day and talking to a superintendent who has 8 schools.
Mm-hmm.
And all those schools have food pantries that the kids can go into and their parents can go into at any time because there's such need there. So I think that we have to, you know, when there's places where there are need, you know, we have to step up.
We do.
We can't have kids going hungry.
Absolutely not.
Yeah.
Well, thank you for all that you do.
And
we look forward to the things that you all can do in the future.
Well, thank you.
Yes.
Well, we're working hard and, you know, it has been a crazy couple of years, but we're excited to be out and, you know, making good things happen in Ohio.
Well, you are, and thank you for your service.
Thank you.
All right. Well, thank you again, Ohio's First Lady, Mrs. Fran DeWine, and thank you for being here in Jackson and the surrounding area.
Thank you. I love being here.
All right.
All right.
All right. Well, we're still at Elizabeth's Hope, but we have moved outside and let the governor's wife go. That's okay, because she has some things to do. But I'm here with
Lisa Cutler, and I'm the executive director of Elizabeth's Hope.
All right. And Lisa, we are here in front of, who are you over there?
I'm Kelly Pruitt. I'm the client services manager for our mobile unit.
Well, very good. And speaking of the mobile unit, we are here. Can you all tell us what it is? And then we're going to go inside and take a tour, which is really cool.
Okay. Yeah. So our mobile unit, we received her back in 2018.
Is her name Sarah?
Yes, we named her Sarah. She actually, part of the donation that we received came from a family, and they got to name her.
Okay.
So her name is Sarah.
Very good. This is Sarah.
So, and then another family from Jackson County area actually paid for the whole entire unit when we had put it out there that this is the direction we were going. But,
wow.
But Sarah actually is equipped with a ultrasound unit.
Okay.
To come alongside of women whenever they're contemplating their options and find themselves maybe in an unplanned pregnancy situation. And so they come, they call here to the mobile unit, and they reach our staff nurse and Kelly, our counselor on board.
Miss Kelly.
And they are able to schedule for a free ultrasound or a pregnancy test, whichever they may be needing. And so they would reach our staff nurse and talk to her and get that scheduled. And so they can come and, you know, we could just come alongside of them and, you know, provide that for them so that they can see, you know, where, you know, like if they have a viable pregnancy or where they are in their pregnancy and explore their options.
You know, and that's wonderful. And the best thing for us to do, it's really bright out here today.
Yes.
We're not used to all this sunshine. Let's head inside the mobile unit and we're going to take a tour. All right. So here we are inside the mobile unit. And can you tell us a little bit about what we're seeing in here? Oh, wait, we found another person.
I'm the nurse, so this is Lauren.
This is Lauren. She's the nurse. Yep.
She's our staff nurse, and she's overseen by our OBGYN, who is also a medical director that oversees all of our medical processes.
Okay.
Her name is Dr. Alicia Thompson. She oversees all of the medical stuff that we do as Elizabeth's Hope. And so a girl, when she calls, she'll reach out to Lauren, and Lauren will go through like her options with her and offer her a free ultrasound to check for viability of pregnancy and whatnot. And so she can come here. And so obviously the mobile unit is equipped with everything we need to do that. Obviously the exam table, an ultrasound unit, and to clean. This is a disinfecting unit. The probes and whatnot.
Yeah.
And so we have all of our medical supplies here on board. The young woman can see her ultrasound up on the TV here.
And that is so cool.
Everything and stuff, so she can see exactly what's going on and get a good picture of what's going on.
Love that. And of course, inside this unit is very discreet. So yeah. Blacked out windows, all that stuff. So you don't have to worry about any of that.
Exactly.
So that's amazing.
Yep. We can see out, but no one can see in. So it's, and it also has shades and stuff that we can pull down if needed.
So. Now Sarah is the mobile unit again that we were talking about. So Sarah travels all over the place. Where does she go?
Yes. Actually, Elizabeth's Hope serves 5 counties in southern Ohio. So we're in Pickway, Ross, Highland, Jackson, and Pike counties. And so we serve all those areas. And then we've been known to go outside of those areas, too, if needed. Yeah.
Good for you.
Yeah. So wherever there may be a need, a woman that maybe doesn't have insurance and can't get an ultrasound or maybe doesn't have a doctor right at the moment, we can come alongside of her and help her in that situation.
You know, and having an advocate when you may be afraid, you may have all kind of questions, you don't know where to turn, thank you for what you do because you're helping ladies along the way.
Yes, absolutely. We just believe in coming alongside of them, you know, no matter what their decision.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, they have a legal right to make whatever decision, you know, they want to. And so we're just here to, without judgment, to come alongside of them, show them that the services that are available to them and help them to make the best choice that they want to make for them.
Well, very good. And thank you again for what you do. And Miss Lisa and Lauren, thank you for giving us a tour of Sarah here, your mobile unit.
Well, thank you guys for coming out. We appreciate you guys too.
All right. And we're going to find out a little bit more about Elizabeth's Hope as we go inside. All right. Well, Lisa and I came back inside, but we found someone else. Can you tell everyone who you are?
So I'm Amanda Nogle, and I'm the center manager for our Jackson location for Elizabeth's Hope.
All right. And Amanda, we are standing here in a room of which we were just in here with the First Lady of Ohio. That's pretty cool. Yes. But we're in a room full of all kind of childhood things. And could you explain what's going on in here?
Yeah. So this is our mom store. What we do is we have a mom's program. And once they sign up for that, they have to sign up for that and attend classes every week. They earn while they learn. So it's one of those programs that we have curriculum that we have the capabilities of sending it to their cell phone now or an email with a link. They do that. They do their part. And then we work with them, build relationship with them, and help them kind of earn what they need for their child or their baby. And they can stay on the mom's program until they're 2 years old.
You know, and Lisa, I think you can probably address this. Like, this will also allow for moms to know what they need, because I'd say a lot of moms don't know.
No, yeah, absolutely. You know, especially if you're a teen mom and whatnot, you don't know what all you may need to have a baby and whatnot. And so we're here to come alongside of them and to show them, you know, teach them, educate them about what's going on, the changes that are happening in their body and stuff like that. And then, of course, the terrible twos and stuff like that, you know, those challenges may come along. So we're there to come alongside of them and help educate them through those processes and walk with them. And so we can show them everything that they may need, whether it be, you know, cribs, car seats, you know,
right.
diapers, wipes, obviously, you will definitely need plenty of those yeah. and formula and whatnot. So they're here to get this. And a lot of these items that we have here are from donations from our community and whatnot. They bring the things. Mm-hmm. And then we also get grants and whatnot from specific organizations. And so like the J. Floyd Dixon grant, we've applied for it and we've received it in this local area in Jackson. And we can buy cribs, car seats, and the bigger ticket items that, you know, usually you don't get donated.
Makes total sense. Yeah. And Miss Lisa, we know that you're busy, so we'll let you get out of here if you want. And then she said she's going to depart the scene. That leaves Amanda. So let's talk for a minute about Elizabeth's Hope in Jackson, if you don't mind. How does someone come to you? When is it time for them to come to you?
When is it time for them mm-hmm. to come to us? So really, they can come to us anytime. They can come to us when they're needing a pregnancy test. We offer free pregnancy tests. We do have the mobile unit. You got all that information. Mm-hmm. When they come to us, and even if they haven't been with us before, we would love to see them. We do have repeat clients. So if a mom's pregnant again and needs to come to us,
okay,
they can come and they stay on until their child is two. But we offer, you know, many different things. We just want to build relationship with them and help those in the community. So if they are even emergency need, if there's something going on and they have an emergency need, like, hey, I don't want to sign up for the mom's program, but I have an emergency need right now, or they know someone who needs help,
yes.
they need to come to us. There's a lot that we could offer them as far as
okay.
emergency diapers, wipes, things like that. Or if, you know, it's a foster parent and they just took a child, different things
help,
like that.
I don't have the
yes,
right
even,
size.
Even grandparents, if they are in a situation where they have a child and they have basic needs for that child, clothing, diapers, okay. wipes, blankets, all that basic stuff, they need to come to us. All they would have to do is fill out a client intake and we would work with them to assess what it is that they need and try to help them from there.
All right. So you all are doing wonderful things out here and we appreciate that, because there's a lot of parents and a lot of babies and toddlers that need you all. So thank you.
Yes, thank you.
All right. And again, Elizabeth's Hope, do you want to give the address and that kind of thing?
Yeah. So we are located down at the Little Brick Mini Mall across from Walmart. Mm-hmm. So it is 14761 State Route 93 in okay. Jackson.
And if you're feeling real frisky, you can go through the cones out front. See if you can pass your driver's test again.
That's true.
I'm not going to do that. Actually, we should do that. That would be fun. We'll make James do that. We'll tape it. Yeah, yeah. All right.
Well, I can do the driving part. I don't think I can do
He said he can't do the cones. Listen, that's only for 16-year-olds, and once you do it once, you don't have to do it again, right?
Right.
I hope. All right. Well, thank you again. This is a beautiful facility. And even if you'd just like to stop in, I'm sure that the gang would be happy to give you a tour.
Yeah, we would love to have you come for a tour.
All right. Well, thank you, girls, for being so hospitable. And here is Elizabeth's Hope. We hope that you've enjoyed.